Lightsabers are a staple of the Star Wars saga, wielded by Jedi Knights, Sith Lords, and sometimes even former Stormtroopers. They are an elegant weapon for a more civilized age, and a pop culture phenomenon, which pretty much any fanboy or girl would love to get their hands on. As I've mentioned before on this channel, the only way that we know of making something similar to a lightsaber would be to use plasmas. These are gases consisting not of neutral atoms or molecules, but freely flowing charged particles. By using very strong magnets, we could confine extremely hot plasmas into a blade which could cut through almost anything. Now, whilst this wouldn't be terribly practical, it doesn't go against the laws of physics. So these sorts of lightsabers are feasible, in principle. But there are some rather unfortunate consequences of a real-life lightsaber, which no amount of clever design or engineering could get around, because of the underlying physics. We've already seen that a lightsaber battle would be far more dangerous than anyone possibly imagined, because with each clash, both blades would explode, releasing that hot plasma due to magnetic reconnection. But how would a real-life lightsaber fare against a different form of attack? Lightning. The prequels showed us that lightsabers seem to attract and absorb or block force lightning attacks. But would the same happen for any lightsaber that we might be able to build? A lot of the details about exactly how and why lightning occurs are still being investigated, but there is some general agreement on some of the basics. The main charging area is in the center of the storm, where the air is rapidly moving upwards and you've got temperatures between minus 15 and minus 25 degrees Celsius. This is perfect for producing a mixture of supercooled cloud droplets, small ice crystals, and soft hail or graupel. The updraft carries the lighter droplets and crystals, whereas the heavier graupel tends to fall, and so collisions occur. These collisions lead to the graupel gaining a static negative charge, whereas the ice crystals become positively charged. And because they're moving away from one another, a separation of charges occurs, where the top of the cloud is positively charged and the bottom of the cloud is negatively charged. Now, thunderclouds, or cumulonimbus clouds, if you want to get technical, are incredibly tall, some tens of thousands of meters, meaning that the bottom of the cloud is closer to the ground than it is to the top of the cloud. That means that electrons in the ground get repelled away by the negatively charged bottom of the cloud, leaving the ground with an ever so slight positive charge. And therefore, an electric field in the air between the ground and the cloud. When that electric field gets big enough, it can break down the air, ionizing it into plasma channels. These first start emanating from the cloud and eventually later from the ground also. You can actually see analogs of these channels in a plasma globe when it's not being touched. All those tendrils of plasma are trying to find a path for current to flow to the ground. Now, plasmas are great conductors of electricity because of their freely flowing charges, in particular, light electrons. The plasma channels in lightning are some 3 quintillion times better at conducting electricity than regular air is, making it about as good as graphite. So when two opposite channels meet, huge electrical currents flow through this conducting path. The electrical discharge superheats the air up to some 50,000 Kelvin, causing it to glow blue-white. Again, we see something similar to this when touching the plasma globe. Since your body, basically being a bag of dilute electrolytes, is a pretty good conductor. Thankfully here, the current is quite low, so that's why you don't feel a shock. You will, however, feel a shock in a demonstration more akin to lightning, a Van de Graaff generator. The static electric charges build up on the two metal spheres until a discharge occurs across the small air gap. Now I want to talk a little bit about lightning rods. They're those metal poles that go from tops of buildings all the way down to the ground. These rods provide a potential low resistance path for the electricity to flow. Now, while there's no actual guarantee that lightning will hit the rod and actually take that path, it is far more probable that it will do because of that low resistance. Okay, back to lightning versus lightsabers. According to Wikipedia, in Star Wars, Force lightning is fundamentally the same as regular lightning. It's a discharge of electricity. And let's not worry about how the Sith Lord manages to make that discharge go from their fingertips through the air. Let's just worry about how a lightsaber would interact with lightning. Well, as we mentioned, plasmas are highly conductive. Many laboratory plasmas, like we might use in a real-life lightsaber, have conductivities similar to most metals. And in many cases, we can treat a lot of plasmas as being infinitely conducting. So a lightsaber's plasma blade, like a lightning rod, provides a nice low-resistance path for all that electricity to flow to the ground. Except that low resistance path happens to also include your conductive body. What's that going to do to you? Well, just like a direct lightning hit, expect severe burns, burst blood vessels, potential cardiac arrest, and about a 10% chance of death. And that's only if the lightning lasts about 30 microseconds. Yeah, that was definitely longer. So, because of its high electrical conductivity, a lightsaber probably would get struck by a lightning bolt, be that of the natural or force variety. But that really wouldn't be a good thing for the person wielding it, so I would suggest don't take your lightsaber out into a rainstorm. Oh dear. Thanks so much for watching all of this video. I hope you enjoyed it. There's a few more Star Wars videos over there. And if you haven't already, do subscribe to get the latest videos from me all the time. And I'd love to hear your comments about lightsabers and the latest Star Wars film down there. See you soon.